This is The Rundown. I'm Hari Srinivasan. Of course, we've been watching the social media revolution as well as the real-life revolution across the Middle East. And here with me is Mazen Nahawi, who's the CEO of News Group, a company out of Dubai that has figured out ways to measure the trends and analyze what's been happening in social media across that region, right?
Right.
So what were you able to predict? That what was Twitter and Facebook and YouTube showing us ahead of time before the actual marches happened in Tahrir Square and other places?
I think the main thing it showed us was the development of a new Arab consciousness. Now, that might sound like a big term, but if we were to drill down a bit more in detail, you'd find that no one actually predicted that the Egypt revolution would happen, or that the Tunisia revolution would happen. But we saw clear trends in the concept of freedom developing in the Arab mind during the past 18 months. And we identified how people being involved on one-to-one relationships, whether it's boy-girl relationships or friend relationships, or being able to be free to choose who they wanted to spend their time with, being free to know what kind of company they wanted to work with, being free in choosing the product that they liked or did not like, being free and being able to comment on what they liked and what they didn't like, developed that consciousness of freedom in the Arab mind. And that was the clear trend. That muscle of freedom was being exercised during the past 18 months. And that's why we feel very strongly that that new consciousness is what led in many ways to the new revolutions that we're looking at today.
So if that consciousness was in the background and growing, was social media a trigger of some sort, whether they could actually communicate, express themselves?
It was an enabler and a catalyst on many tactical things, but it was more importantly an enabler on a strategic thing, which is the psychology of freedom. And there's been a lot of social science research on the psychology of freedom. But when you drill down to it in terms of revolutionary activity, yes, it did allow people to communicate, to organize, to share information, to be able to oppose government propaganda and state media and so on. But is social media the cause of the revolution? No. But it is a major driver and a major enabler.
So what were you able to see? You were able to see demographic information of who was actually out on social media, and you were actually starting to use natural language processing to see what they were saying. So who was saying what?
Many people were saying many different things. You've got pro-government people who were trying to advocate for the government. They were a minority, usually older people working out with state institutions, state media. But the vast majority were younger people who were, in fact, advocating for major change and major reform. You have a lot of good things in terms of people calling for accountability, freedom, justice, doing away with corruption. But we found new and worrying trends, such as people wanting a greater role for government in their life. But hold on just a minute. We've overthrown the government. Why are we calling for more government in more government jobs, higher government wages, more state planning in the economy? So you have this dichotomy right now in that virtual liberty square. People want more freedom, but they think that government may be the answer.
So it's a neo-socialism that you see in social media that you perhaps don't hear on the streets.
Right.
So were you able to get a good cross-section of society?
Yes, I would say so. I mean, today we have over 80 million people in the Arab world who are online, and that is a very large number. And if you were to add people who are using cell phones, it's perhaps every adult and every young adult over the age of 16. So from a scientific sampling point of view, if you're looking at 80 million plus Arabs online out of a population of 330 million, that's a very definitive number, that it's a very good representative sample.
And you were also able to see certain trend lines on how particular individuals in these revolutions were faring, almost like a Q rating or a plus or minus rating.
Correct.
Before we had any kind of immediate polling data on how is Mohamed El-Baradei faring in the crowds. Do they like him? Do they not like him?
Sure.
Mubarak as well. You were able to just go ahead and look at particular keywords?
Well, keywords are an important part of being able to take tens of millions of conversations and filter them down into a few hundred thousand, which are then manually gone through and analyzed. What we do is influencer analysis, find out the quantitative data, how many people are following that individual, and then the qualitative data, what kind of message penetration, message resonance, favorability is associated with that influencer, and how that influencer is connecting with other ideas and trends which are evolving on the internet and on social media in general. And that way you can identify who they are, what they are doing, who they are influencing, and start getting together pretty good data, which in scientific terms we call prediction, but in layman's term we call guessing, and find out where it's heading.
So where is it heading? Where is the next major revolution, or where are the right preconditions, the right kindling, the right consciousness, where does that exist today that want to overthrow their status quo?
Well, that's a big question, and it's difficult to predict who will be next to go, or if anybody will be the next to go. I think what is the next stage of that consciousness? I think that's really the big thing. And you have a big conflict in that virtual Liberty Square in the mind of the Arab young individual. Who do we want to be? You're going to see, and this is much more interesting to me as opposed to who will be the next president of Yemen. It will be, how are we going to define our identity going into the future? Are we going to remain a collection of 22 disparate states, or are we going to create a new pan-Arab reality? What kind of people do we want to be? Do we want to be more on the liberal or on the conservative side? What will our religious values become? The more we break away from centralization, the more we break away from the politics of aristocracy, the politics of absolutism, the individual will be empowered. But how will that translate into day-to-day life? These are the major questions. With or without the revolutions, many of the Arab leaders today are aging, they're on their way out. Even the more aristocratic and tougher ones are preparing to leave. They see the writing on the wall and they're on their way out. But who are we as a people? Where are we going? And there's a big conflict of ideas right now. We have the very well-organized religious establishment represented mainly in the Muslim Brotherhood, who are well-organized and putting forward very compelling arguments. But you have a nascent secular and liberal movement which is starting to push back. But you don't have them organized in the political and economic way the Muslim Brotherhood is. A big issue will be, can the young people of today organize and use social media to organize political parties, NGOs, to be able to express what they want to do and where they want to go?
So all of these tough conversations about the future of the Arab identity, it's happening on social media right
happening.
Now?
It's happening. We see it clearly. You're starting to hear words like, I'm a liberal, I'm a secular person, I'm a Republican, I'm a monarchist, I want a constitutional monarchy. What does a constitutional monarchy mean? We're finding very interesting conversations, as in, well, I'm from Lebanon, I'm from Syria, I'm from Jordan. We existed a long time before Islam came to that part of the world. What does it actually mean to be an Arab? People are starting to wonder about, why are we called the Middle East? East with reference to who? Do the people in China and India think that we are to their east or to their middle? Certainly not. And I think you're going to have a real explosion in identity debate going in the Arab world. And these are the key trends that we'll be looking for. They are the ones that will identify the body politic of the future.
All right. Mazen Nahawi, CEO of News Holdings out of Dubai. Thanks so much for your time.
Thank you.
This is The Rundown. I'm Hari Srinivasan. Stay with us.